I've got my running shoes, my cycling shoes, my helmet, my camera gear, my hydration, nutrition, medical, sunglasses, tri belt. The bike itself looks ready, I think. It's got its wheels on. It's race day. Since I started running races over a year ago now, I've done all sorts. Ultra marathons, trail runs, obstacle course races, everything in between. And although each one is very slightly different, there's the basic fundamental that's the same. It's all predominantly running. So I've become very familiar with them. I've developed a real comfort about attending. I'm relaxed, I know what to expect. It's like being married. But today is very different. There are parts of it that I have no idea what to expect. It's like a first date. I'm nervous in a way that I haven't been about a new event for ages. How's it going to go? How am I going to do? Am I going to get badly injured? Typical first date concerns. I am now running so late as well that I need to split so there isn't even time to do all the pump jokes that I've got. Okay, I'm here and I'm looking around and lots of people are setting up like little mini garages at the back of their cars to work on their very flash looking bikes with lots of tools. I feel untooled. I don't have enough tools. I should have brought more tools. I wouldn't know what to do with them, so it would have been pointless, but at least I could look the part. Right, here's a score. It is a 1 lap 3k run, a 4 lap totaling 15k bike ride, and then another lap of the 3k run. They're doing socially distanced starting, so normally it'd be a mass start, you all go off together, but because on a bright sunny day running through the woods, there's also a very high chance of catching coronavirus, they are starting us off in a sort of staggered formation. I'm not quite sure how it's going to work, but I think the gist is that a few people go off every now and again. It doesn't really matter because it's all chip timed, so makes no difference. Okay, I need to go and register and then get ready. Man, they have so many tools. Like, this guy looks like he's building his bike from scratch. People are starting to gather for the start briefing that's about to happen. I've just been out and done a practice lap. My bike is in transition, ready to go, all very exciting. My trainers sat there, my bike shoes sat next to it. My trainers are on my feet, just checking, they are. I just need to calm and then go over and race. Got a couple of cameras on the bike. In fact, I've got my Hero Sessions on the bike that I haven't used since I came back from Namibia a few years ago. So they're having a little day out in the sunshine. Gonna sit the GoPro 8 on my chest and see how we get on. So yeah, next stop will be at the start line.
So watching this back with you, pretty small group, 51 total runners. I don't know if this particular event attracts those sort of numbers normally or if it was low because of the coronavirus situation, but it was a nice size group. There was plenty of distancing between everybody and there was enough people there to make it feel like a proper event. So good sized group. The social distancing rules were pretty straightforward. They had us all stay apart from each other. For example, they had us funnel through to get to the start line. We all had to queue up behind each other. Normally a mass start for this race, but we all line up. We take it in turns to go three at a time to a starting block where they let us off with 10 or 15 second intervals. So everybody was sort of kept apart at the beginning at least. And then once you're into the run, you're into the woods, the distance between everybody is naturally just maintained anyway. The start line actually isn't where I'm stood now. The start line's up slightly further ahead. So once they set us off and we're running towards that start line, I didn't bother clicking my watch until I go across it. Chip timed the whole thing, so it mattered not. As long as I kicked in at the start line proper, that was where the clock started, so that's what I did. In theory, they had us all start off on an honesty grid basis, the idea being that if you thought you were going to be one of the fastest people, you started at the front and got out of everyone's way, and slower people started at the back and didn't have to worry about being passed. I wasn't really sure where to place myself. Normally, on a regular run, especially a trail run, I'd regard myself as being out of 50 people probably in the top 10 or 15. On this race, I started more in the middle. People looked pretty hardcore. There was a lot of Lycra. That was my guide to how hardcore this group of people were. Actually, I'd worried that wearing my triathlon suit would make me stand out. Actually, not wearing it would have made me stand out. I fitted in perfectly, as much as somebody that's 6'6" and 220 pounds dressed in bright orange Lycra can fit in. But I wasn't out of place. So hardcore group. I started in the middle, and actually that was probably about right. I spent the early part of the run catching up with a few people and overtaking them, but psychologically that was nice. It was just nice to go past people, but not so many people that I felt like I'd started way too far back and had messed up their process of lining us all up in the right place. So it was going quite well, especially once we got into the woods. I have learned my trade, sounds very grand, doesn't it? Running in woods, doing Spartan races, obstacle course races. There is something I love about running off-road, but there's something primal about running through the woods. The route itself was great. There were no hills, which is nice. It was all flat, dry, bone dry everywhere. Nothing technical, dodging a few trees. All very simple, but a lot of fun as well. So good course. And this is now coming up to the end of the first 3K run. And I tried to pace myself on doing what felt like a sort of 4 minute 30 kilometer pace, which is a kind of a regular off-road quick pace for me. I felt like I'd run, but I didn't feel exhausted. The last thing I wanted to do was jump on the bike for 20K and be knackered. So felt good at this point, came up to the bike. It was where I'd left it, which was nice. Chucked on my shoes, took the sunglasses off. I'd noticed running through the wood that it had been quite dark, and running speed, it was fine. I did not want to go whizzing through the wood on the bike, not being able to see clearly. So I took the risk of taking the glasses off. I say risk because I wear contact lenses normally, not today. And if I get something in my eye, a bit of dirt, a bit of muck, with the contact lens, it's a disaster. So I always normally wear protective glasses of some sort when I'm cycling. Had I known it was going to be that dark, and for next time, I will have some clear lenses, because I could have done with them. Took the risk. I would rather be risking something going in my eye that might not happen than not being able to see, which would have been the case had I left them on. Hit the cameras and off I go. Now, this first part of the cycle ride was this very flat, slightly downhill, grassy section where I've whizzed along, and I got a sense that this might be the way it was going to continue. That was very deceiving. It wasn't the way I was going to continue at all. Just after this section, the grass got a bit longer, got a bit rutted, and it felt draining. In fact, it was quite nice actually, because I heard afterwards another guy say to his mate how draining it was to cycle on that. He compared it to like cycling in sand. He was right. I thought it was just me. It was hard work to cycle on. My quads, just a few minutes in, were burning at this point. Once we got into the wood, it was better. It was really hard packed. I'm riding a 29er, so it rolls nice and fast. That was kind of a blessing and a curse at the same time. An extra large 29er with a 100 kilogram rider on it is something that on flat, fast terrain will move at speed. Going through a really tight, twisty circuit is much harder. I have to change direction a lot. Clearly, that's what the route's doing. And it's simply harder to change direction if you have an awful lot of weight behind that momentum. The little guys were flying past me, and I'm sure they were also far better cyclists as well, but I could have done with probably 40 kilograms less to go around corners. It was draining. Stopping, turning, accelerating again was hard work. Before the first lap was up, I was thinking, I'm going to get humbled today. I had gone into this event, as I do with most of these events, with two mindsets. One was, oh my goodness, I hope I am not a complete failure and don't come last or get hurt or something. The other mindset is, oh, I wonder if I could win. And no matter how much I tell myself, don't be stupid, that is a voice that persists, which is quite beneficial. Whenever I get overly concerned, I just listen to the egomaniac. By this point, that voice had disappeared. I don't know where that had gone, but it had left for the day. I was left only with the, oh my goodness, this is hard voice. It's demoralising when people go past you. It's also demoralising when people go past you quickly. I felt like I feel in the swimming pool. I'm on the bike, I'm pedalling as fast as I feel my legs will go, and I am a reasonably powerful cyclist. I know that I'm producing a reasonable amount of watts, and somebody will come past me like I am standing still. And my brain is thinking, I don't quite understand what they're doing that I'm not doing. How's that work? And it happens in the pool as well. I'm whizzing along through the pool and somebody will come past me. And again, I watch them and think, you're doing what I'm doing. What the hell is going on? So I had that experience, which is not a bad experience to have every now and again. Kind of puts you in your place. And another thing that was highlighted to me very early into the race was that I had not practiced properly. I had gone out on the practice lap and ridden it slowly. My thinking was learn the twists and the turns, learn where the problem areas are. And actually there weren't really any. It was a course that had I not practiced, I'd have been at no real disadvantage. It was pretty obvious where the track went. There was good visibility everywhere. What I should have done was practiced going at race speed, because I came off the practice course thinking, hey, it's really smooth and fast. I'll stick a little bit of extra tire pressure in because that will give me a faster rolling resistance and I'll go quicker. So I jacked the tires up a tiny bit. When I then went back and did it in the race, my extra hard tires were hitting tree roots and bits of uneven terrain clearly a lot faster. And it was causing them to bounce around a lot. And because it's a hardtail with no suspension on the rear and limited suspension on the front with rock hard tires, it was really skittish. It was bouncing around over things that I would have realized had I done the practice lap properly, because I read it too slow. I had no idea that would be the case until suddenly I'm trying to accelerate hard over things and finding that the back wheel is spinning up, not because it's losing grip, but because it's just bouncing off the floor and spinning in the air. So, stupid mistake. And then I came back into the second transition, so getting rid of the bike. And actually, it was a relief to get rid of the bike. I guess it's something that you get used to, but I rode the entire bike ride worried my bike was about to fail. It's not something I'm used to. I normally have to only worry about me failing. Having to also worry about something falling off the bike and leave me stranded was a worry that I was glad to be getting rid of. So getting rid of the bike, going out for the run. I was also telling myself that I could go out into the run and basically catch up the people that had come past me. I kind of had the guy that had left that tells me, you're going to win this. He decided to come back and was saying, we are going to catch those cyclists now. Let's see if they can bloody run. And so I went off into the run, initially feeling pretty positive. Again, it started with that smooth, slightly downhill, hard-packed run. I flew down there, it was all feeling very good. And then I got into the woodland section and I went into it with the same thoughts I'd had from the previous time when I'd gone into it fresh, thinking, this is my, how do I explain this in a way that is as ridiculous to explain as it felt at the time? I went into the wood thinking, this is where I operate. Does that sound pretentious enough? That's what that guy was telling me. This is my domain. There you go, all that sort of nonsense. I'm gonna catch them. And then I started tripping over tree roots. And I thought, oh shit, this isn't my domain at all. I'm useless. My legs were just absolutely whacked. I was not picking my feet up enough. I was stumbling, I was tripping over my own feet. Anybody watching would not be thinking, oh, this is where this guy operates. They'd be thinking, this man looks drunk. It was hard, hard going. After about a kilometre maybe, my legs started to sort of get used to running again, but by then I was under no illusions that I was going to be catching many people at all. I think I caught a couple of people on the run, but not many. I was just too busy trying to stay upright for most of it. And then the finish line came up, thank God. And that was it. It was good. It was an awful lot of fun. Nice to get beaten by people, actually. It was nice to be overtaken. I sometimes work under the delusion that as long as I just keep buying t-shirts that are a little bit too small for me and compare myself to people that do their weekly shop at KFC, that I'm some sort of elite example of fitness. And clearly, when I go along to an event like this, I'm surrounded by people who, in some cases, are way, way fitter than me. And actually, that's quite nice. Whenever I get complacent, it's nice to realise that there are, on the ladder of whatever ladder I'm on, there's an awful lot more rungs above me. So that's a good thing. I like being put in my place sometimes. That is no bad thing at all. In terms of what went badly and what went well, actually most of it went exactly according to plan. The tri-suit was brilliant. It was exactly as it's supposed to be, really. I didn't notice it, didn't flap about, didn't rub anywhere. Comfortable on the bike, comfortable on the run, perfect. The bike worked. Nothing broke on it, did exactly as it's supposed to. Actually, it's easy to go through what didn't go quite so well. What did not go quite so well? Practice on the bike. I should have gone out in advance and practiced. I didn't, and so consequently I had the problem with the tires, but that's not really a problem with the bike. That's my understanding of how to set the bike up properly. In fact, occasionally I tell myself, it would have been great if I was doing this 20 years ago, rather than left it till 46, But actually, the joy of doing it now is that in 2020, when I have a problem like that, I can jump on the internet and Google ideal tire pressure for a mountain bike on a cross-country race, and instantly all the information I could possibly want is there. I love learning new stuff, and I like to be able to take it forward and do something positive with it. So, brilliant. Happy to have learnt something new. Every day's a school day. Apart from that, the bike was fine. Tools. I didn't take my tools around with me. Peer pressure. I looked at everyone else's bikes and they didn't have tools. I had my little toolkit under the saddle, my little pump on the frame. All I needed was my briefcase on a little rack on the back, and I could have pedaled off to work. And so I took my tools off because I wanted to look the part. And actually, it would have made no difference to my performance had I had them with me. And yet, had I had a puncture or something, I'd have been stuck. I'd have been out of the race pretty much. Whereas if I'd had my tools with me, it takes me 4 or 5 minutes to change a puncture on the bike and I'd have been on my way. It would have ruined my time, but it wouldn't have ruined my day. So next time, I will take my tools with me, and if I pass someone at the side, broken down, I will laugh and cycle on by and wave my briefcase at them. Tools, next time. What else with the bike? Everything else on the bike was fine. Garmin. This is me, again, not the tool. There's a running theme here of the problems being me. I had discovered how to use the triathlon mode on Garmin. It is brilliant. You set it up for triathlon or duathlon, and each time you come to the end of an event and the start of a transition, you hit the button and it stops recording. In this case, it should have stopped recording the run, start recording the transition. When I leave the transition on the bike, I hit it again, it starts recording the bike ride and so on. Afterwards, you get a recording of the run, the transition, the bike, the transition, the run, you get the idea. That didn't happen. I came into transition one, I hit the button, and it stopped the whole thing. So I then started the whole thing again and ended up just recording it as one big lump and cursed the thing the whole way around. Until I remembered on the way home, the way to set a stop into a transition rather than stopping the whole thing is to use the lap button, makes perfect sense, not the stop button. So, me again. Triathlon mode, brilliant. My ability to use triathlon mode, useless. What else? Shoes. My Lone Peak Ultras have reached the end of their useful life with me. I love them, but the tread's getting very low. Wasn't a problem on this run because the ground was pretty hard packed, but there'll be no use as soon as it starts raining and getting a bit wet underfoot. The bigger problem with these was that I put elastic laces in them so I could change shoes fast, and that worked. I was very quick at changing my shoes. The trouble is, these are particularly wide, even for an ultra wide toe box shoe. That's good, it means my feet can move in the front of the shoe. But for that to work best, you need good lockdown on the middle of the foot so your foot is held stable and your toes can move around freely. The trouble is, the elastic laces meant that my midfoot could also move around, and with the wide expanse up front here, effectively my foot was moving around inside the shoe too much. And on the second run, when I was a bit less stable on my feet, I found myself rolling out of the shoe almost. So that has not worked. That, in conjunction with the worn tread, means I've just bought a pair of Lone Peak 4.5s, which apparently are slightly narrower as well. So I will be using those on my next run, which is, what is my next run? 20 miles across the Brecon Beacons in 2 weeks' time with Nixon and new shoes. So these have been great, but are now going to be retired. They go to my father, who at 83 might be the oldest owner of about 10 pair of Ultras out there. He does the gardening in them, so they are off to the vegetable patch. Where did I come, more importantly? Now, if you are a regular viewer of my channel, you will know that I like to come above average. If you're not a regular viewer, to explain, if there's 100 people, I want to be in the top 50. I don't mind if I'm 50th, but I want to be in the top 50. If I'm not, I like to work to get there. 51 runners in total. I came 20th. So, in the top half, happy with that. Breaking it down, on the run, one, I was 10th. On the bike ride, I was 25th. Scraped top half, literally. Run two, 13th, 20th overall. To break it down further, the 40 to 49 males, 23 runners in that category. That is the largest, that's almost half the field, were 40 to 49 year old middle-aged men. Don't know what that says. I was 6th on the run, 13th on the bike, and 9th on the second run, 11th overall out of 23, so that's above average. Although 13th on the bike out of 23 is below average, so can't be perfect. Overall, 20 out of 51, happy enough with that. And it was a great day. They ran it brilliantly. They adhered to all the government directives that they needed to adhere to, so they ran it in a legit way for the COVID situation. It didn't in any way detract from the day for me at all. If you were there and felt that it was unsafe in any way, then goodness me, you probably shouldn't be out and about. It was a very, very well organised day, and it shows other races that are getting cancelled left, right and centre that you can put it on and do it properly. What else? That's pretty much it. What's next? Next is next weekend. I have a supathlon, continuing the athlon theme. Paddleboard, 1K, 5K run. I did it last year. I came third, remarkably. I was second out of the water. I got overtaken on the run by one person, came third. And I'm a faster runner this year than last year, but I've since forgotten how to paddleboard, so swings and roundabouts, we'll see how that goes. And then beyond that, I've got the Brecon Beacons with the dog run coming up in the following weekend. So that's it. Hope you found it useful and interesting. If you did, like, subscribe, all that jazz. And yeah, check back next time for the next video. How's it going to go? How am I going to do? Am I going to wake up tomorrow unconscious in a forest? Typical first date concerns. Am I going to get beaten by hundreds of other people? Typical first date concerns. Will my lycra impress them? Typical first date concerns.